Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better. Remember to let her into your heart. Then you can start to make it better.
Brentford aren't always thought about as the most glamorous of clubs. Although it nearly became a rugby club following a vote on a winter sport alternative for the rowing club in 1889, it has grown a fairly sizeable fan base, with fans across the world supporting the Bees as they battle through the Football League. After a seventh successive failure in the playoffs, in April 2014, Alan Judge stepped up to tuck a penalty away that, should Wolves defeat Rotherham that afternoon, would seal promotion. A 6-4 thriller at Molineux sent the Bees to the Championship for the first time since 1993. But as history tells us, Brentford have never really made it easy for themselves.
I suppose one of the biggest, wake-up calls we had was, when we won the fourth division. I think it was, we was winning 4-0 and at half-time, I think I'm right in saying, I think we'd scored about 94 goals that season, and with the four we'd scored up to half time, we'd taken up to 98, and everyone was hoping we'd get two more to get 100 goals in a season. But we came out for the second half, and we ended up only winning the game 4-3, and everyone seemed to think we must have gone on the beer at half time.
Situated in the heart of West London, Brentford has several other clubs nearby, including the likes of Chelsea and local rivalries in Fulham and Queen's Park Rangers.
I try to tell you a story about being playing at Queen's Park Rangers. Oh, they hated me there, you know. And I was playing on the terraces side, and this Tony Shepherd, who was one of their star men, he didn't like me at all, you know. And he kept trying to keep away from me. And halfway through the first half, going to pick the ball up, and the ball rolled right near the crowd, you see. And as I picked the ball up, I said, they were all booing me and doing everything. And I said, has anybody seen Ernie Shepherd? And after that, they were cheering me.
The rivalry with QPR would intensify, as in 1967, they launched a takeover bid that threatened the club's existence.
The fans didn't want it happen. The players didn't want it happen. The board didn't want it happen. And in that little period of, say, a month, the players were worried because we could be out of job. And we just said it was scandalous, you know. At the end of the day, we wanted to play for the football club that we'd signed for. We didn't want to play for Queen's Park Rangers. We wanted to play for Brentford Football Club. Now, and they might have gone out of existence.
We did sponsored runs, sponsored walk, the players from Brighton to Griffin Park, in which Tommy Higginson, one of our senior players, ran all the way and got lost. Yeah, well, that's par for the course, isn't it, for Tom, really?
After fans and players alike rallied to raise money, Brentford was saved. However, just a few years later, disaster struck as a fire in the boiler room threatened to destroy Griffin Park.
Well, I had a phone call. I was a key holder. I had a phone call. It's on fire. You need to get to the ground. So you're a key holder. There were people walking down the road as if it was a match. There were just people walking down the road to this. You could see the flame. You could see the light from Bush Corner. But as you got to Brentford and say Ealing Road, there were people walking down the road. I got out of the car where the bricklayers used to be, walked round the corner. Walked into the ground, and there was Martin Lant, the chairman, and I think Terry Hurlock was there because he lived locally. And there were people already there just watching the stand burning down.
Over the years, Brentford have maintained a strong youth system, producing players such as Alan Hawley, Peter Gelson, and the terrible twins of George Francis and Jim Towers, a strike force that netted 299 goals between them. More recently, former defender Michael Dobson and current club captain Kevin O'Connor were brought through by a fellow graduate, Bob Booker.
Good lads. You know, we had a great time. You know, they came straight from school as 15, obviously been through the youth sort of setup, but finally joined us as YTS boys. And I really loved that time. You know, we had a great bunch. You know, we had Marcus Bent, Michael Dobson, Kevin O'Connor, Kevin Rapley, and they was the lads that we got through to sign as pro, and all went on to do pretty well. And Kevin O'Connor still plying his trade at Brentford, which is great to see. But they was just a pleasure to work with. You know, in them days, they worked as apprentices, not just like young footballers. You know, they had to do all the chores, they had to clean the boots, they had to clean the dressing rooms. You know, but when you got the players sitting there after a 2-year apprenticeship, like the Dobsons and the O'Connors and the Rapleys and the Bents, and you tell them they got a year pro contract to go and prove themselves, it's the best feeling in the world, and probably the best feeling in the world for them as well. So they was a pleasure to work with, really were.
Regardless of how the team fare on the pitch, from relegation battles to promotion challenges, one thing has always remained true. The fans, singing Hey Jude at the top of their voices, travelling from all over to see their side play.
So I live in northern Idaho, in the northwest of the USA. A town called Coeur d'Alene, which is just at the foot of the Rocky Mountains. When I come to see the Bees, I fly from Spokane, Washington to Seattle, and then Seattle to London, and that's about 4,300 miles each way. And when I was like 8 or 9 years old, the gentleman upstairs had a son my age, and he said to me, "Do you want to go see Brentford?" And I had no idea who or what Brentford was, but it was something to do outside of the house. So we jump on a 657 trolley bus, and we come to Griffin Park, and that was that.
My parents, their first date was Aldershot away back in, I think it was 1968. My poor mum had to pay her own coach fare and her own to buy her own program, but they did win 4-2. So my dad made sure that she came along to every match after that, which is really good. And then obviously they got married and they had me, and I was then dragged along to every match from the age of 4.
One of the things that makes this club special, when my daughter was 13 and my son was 11, we went to watch a training session at Jersey Road. Martin Allen came over to us, we're the only people there, and he came over, he said, "Oh, have you come from far?" I said, "Yeah, about 40 miles. And I said, "Oh, it's my daughter's birthday today." "Come with me," he said, Martin Allen. And he's called the players, they're all walking off the pitch, they all had a hard session. "Wait there, you lot, stand on the steps." He said, "Right, Lizzie, you go up and join them." So she went up and joined them, and he made them sing happy birthday to her. Now, that was a magic moment for 13. That's a real football club. That's a family football club. That's why we support you. That's why we support Brentford.
It's my life, and it will never change.
Family club, yeah. Really important family club.
When that guy upstairs said, "Do you want to go to Brentford?" that changed my life. And, you know, ever since then, I've been a dedicated, loyal fan, and I'm proud to say that.
With everything happening in its history, fans can be forgiven for thinking that Brentford is cursed. Although it did have a top-flight spell, the club also managed to win all of its home fixtures one year and on another finished second, yet still miss out on promotion both times. Some said that when Reading pipped Brentford to promotion in the final game of the season in 2002, we were destined to never leave the third tier the right way. So when the opportunity reappears against Doncaster at Griffin Park 11 years later, history couldn't repeat itself, surely.
Brentford have a penalty in added time. If they score, they are up to... And he's... Oh! He's in a crossbar! And he's come down! And... Oh, my...
Fortunes have well and truly changed now Matthew Benham has taken ownership of the club, with Mark Warburton leading the squad with his backroom staff upwards into the Championship.
Oh, it's Dallas! What a goal!
He's passed it into the...
The future for Brentford certainly is bright, and with Lionel Road only just a few years away, who knows how far we can go.
What an incredible finish to this game!